Okay, great. Thanks so much for this very kind introduction. I don't think the genius thing gonna live up to completely, but so what I want to do is again have hopefully a little bit of a conversation. But Sergio asked me specifically to focus also on the regenerative medicine aspect because I think you haven't covered that as much, and that's something which is very topical right now for us because we are just on the verge, hopefully, of starting a clinical trial actually this year after nearly 20 years of preparation. And so it's an exciting time to kind of discuss that topic. I have some other topics afterwards. We'll see how it goes time-wise, both on disease modeling. And if you're wondering what this thing there is that was moving, that's actually an organoid that we tried to make, which is kind of a crazy looking organoid. So if we have time, we get into that maybe a little bit as well. So to start off, again, I want to focus on really the issue of cell therapy. And just kind of as a matter of introduction, obviously people have thought about cell therapy for a long time. And you can think of what kind of cells you might want to use. And what has been used so far mostly are actually primary cells. You think, for example, in the blood, you have hematopoietic stem cells, in the skin for burn, you can have keratinocytes, stem cell-like cells, and so forth. But now what really has starting to make a sea change is really that obviously we can derive potentially any of those cells from pluripotent sources. And there are multiple examples, and again, I will focus primarily on the Parkinson's disease, but mention a few other ones as well. And the advantage here is now you hopefully can make a cell that's quite analogous to the primary cell, but you can make it tons of it. You can make billions. You can store them, freeze them, and make them nearly as precise as you would have a drug that's fully specified. And then another area that people think might come in the future is really that maybe you don't even need the cells directly to be transplanted, but you convert them in vivo, that you actually reprogram tissues. And right now that's still at the experimental side, but there are major efforts, for example, in the cardiac side, where people actually try to do that, and companies have been founded under such ideas. And again, fundamentally, obviously, you can think that, talking about regenerative medicine, nearly any organ that undergoes degeneration could be targeted. Now, some of them are going to be more difficult and some are going to be more easy. But really, the reason why there has been over the last 2-3 years a lot of excitement about regenerative medicine yet again is that we really can make those cells from pluripotent cells, and I hope to convince you that a little bit later, that we understand more and more about the mechanisms of how these cells work. I will give you some examples of that as well. And also, there is already slowly but steadily some success stories. And I think the success story recently was particularly in the field of cancer, where people actually modified T cells, the so-called CAR T cells, which have specific chimeric receptors and that have led to actual cures in certain particular leukemias that were previously incurable. And so this kind of appetite has been kind of increased also even for companies now to get into that and to really having a lot of money flowing into that. Now, again, as I mentioned before, there's actually not so many out there. We might be able to make many cell types, but the question is really how can you actually choose the disease that has a shot? And again, factors that are really critical is you want to really have the right cell, and you want to have it at the scalable cell that you can fully qualify it. Sergio mentioned just QC for organoids. Here it's even more critical to make QC if you have something you're going to stick into people. You'll need to have a disease that has a clear clinical need that can currently not really be addressed, and you also need to have typically animal models that you can actually test it. And in all those cases, in many cases, the bottleneck has been also immune suppression, because many of the diseases, for example, in diabetes, that's currently one of the main challenges, that maybe you can make the cells, but you still have the immune response trying to destroy them, or in many other peripheral organs, just simply overcoming the immune response is a major challenge. Now, in the brain and in the eye, that's not such a huge problem, and in fact, that by kind of with regard to pluripotent cells, the main first cell that really has been more widely used towards the clinic is actually so-called RPE cells. So those are pigmented cells that are at the back of your retina and that nourish basically the retina, which has basically the sensory cells that basically receive the light signal. And so it's by now about 10 different groups or so that want to go forward, and about 5 already in the clinic to really moving that forward. Actually, the very first one was an effort in spinal cord injury, a company called Geron at the time, that used human yeast-derived cells, and they went over the last 5 to 10 years, actually it was a really slow process. They have now recently just moved in the so-called phase 2 study. So the way that works is clinical trial first, the phase 1 is just pure safety, which means for this company, for example, they had to inject those cells, but the regulatory agency made them to inject the cells in a way where they kind of knew that this dose cannot work. It was way too low. But now they went into phase 2 where they actually think they have a dose that should theoretically work. And again, we can discuss the rationale for some of those disorders, because if you think about what is spinal cord injury, spinal cord injury is not the loss of cells. At least most of it is not the loss of cells. It's the loss of connectivity from the cortex typically to the motor neuron. And so the question is, how much can you really do, for example, with remyelinating the somewhat demyelinated axons? That's kind of the rationale for this therapy. And there are some newer efforts by several groups where they hope to actually bypass neuronal function. You put in certain interneurons, you get a signal from the cortex to end on the interneurons, and then it gets kind of channeled and basically transmitted eventually to the motor neuron. Again, it's all a bit questionable mechanistically whether we understand how that works, but that's something that has moved forward quickly. And again, what I'm going to focus on is primarily Parkinson's, where we don't really have yet an ES or an IPS product in the clinic, but we are very, very close. Now, we just discussed before DualSMAD, and I just want to make one more plug here for DualSMAD in the case that's actually not really a useful technique just for making new ectoderm. But we've just recently published a paper, kind of a resource article, that where you can use the same kind of differentiation scheme with just a few modifications to make then also the peripheral nervous system, sensory cells, or skin cells quite effectively. And the reason why I put that is, again, even though I'm going to focus primarily on Parkinson's disease, our vision is much bigger. So with this platform, you can now make about 40 or 50 cell types already quite routinely, and we can most of them make at reasonably high scale. Not everything is like up to GMP standards, obviously, but we have quite a few cells in a pipeline that eventually, if our Parkinson model moves forward, could go along a similar path. So that brings me then really to kind of introducing Parkinson's disease. And so Parkinson's disease was first described by, as you might guess, James Parkinson. So he was a neurologist in London, actually, and he just kind of spotted people walking through the streets of London and saw that they actually had this very unusual shuffling step and that they were typically having various motor symptoms that he actually described quite accurately at that time already. Now, he actually was not vain enough to call it Parkinson's disease. The guy who did was actually Jean-Martin Charcot, who was a very famous neurologist in Paris. And he really started to bring real science into it, not just the description of Parkinson's disease, but for example, he then measured the tremor, that's the shaking that is very characteristic of Parkinson's disease, and they showed that the tremor you have both when you are basically in rest or if you initiate the movement. And that's different, for example, from certain cerebellar or other type of tremors where you actually pretty much rock solid if you don't think about it, but then you have an intention tremor. But just as an example, he really was describing things in great detail. Again, the gait was measuring it. He showed so-called micrography. That's actually a very sensitive feature that people, when they at the early stage of Parkinson's disease, they start writing smaller and smaller, which is kind of an interesting tidbit, but it's actually quite consistent. And again, you have actually many more symptoms which are shown here, and at least the symptoms here, they are all related to the loss of a very specific cell type in the brain, which are midbrain dopamine neurons located in the substantia nigra here. What these neurons do, they project up to the striatum, both the putamen and the caudate. And typically, for you here in this room, you should have about 400,000 of those on each side of your brain. Actually, not that many, so it's 400,000. Once you lose about half of those, you get Parkinson's disease symptoms. And then it continues and you lose more and more cells. And again, that's obviously the classic features of Parkinson's are all related to that loss of dopamine neurons, but it's important to mention it's not only the loss of those cells. Because there are also so-called non-motor symptoms. For example, even more sensitive than the micrography is the loss of smell. So I always kind of, not really joking, but I mean, if you actually can still smell very well, you enjoy your wine and your other things, you have a good chance over the next 10 years not to get Parkinson's disease. Again, something quite sensitive and predictive much earlier than you have the motor symptoms. And then again, you have also typical sleep disorders that are also quite predictive and early on, and mood disorders orthostatic hypertension, and even you get late also cognitive defects. You get basically accumulation of Lewy bodies in various regions of the brain. And so the problem, obviously, when you talk about the disease, I say, okay, what do we know about the disease? What's going on? And we know quite a bit by now. There were a lot of genetic studies, and I think most of the recent knowledge comes from genetics, showing the involvement of various genes, some of them with very, very high penetrance. So if you have those genes, you're pretty much guaranteed going to get Parkinson's disease at some point, and some with much lower penetrance. And if you then look what these genes do, you get various classes of functions as shown here. And maybe the most dramatic ones typically is mitochondrial dysfunction, that's pretty much clear, and also lysosomal function. And they might directly or indirectly then also relate to actually alpha-synuclein accumulation. So you have all these various mechanisms, which is great. The problem is none of those mechanisms has led to a therapy. So right now there is nothing. There's basically still the same therapy that we had 50 or 60 years ago. And so maybe in 20 years we're going to know how to deal with that. But right now we are still basically kind of in the dark ages with regard to therapy. And it's clearly important that we have better therapies, because if you look in the US alone, it's about 1 million patients, and worldwide it's actually more than 5. It's probably about 10 million patients that are known to have Parkinson's disease. And oops, that's a problem. I should have done that before. Let me just shut that off here. Oh. Too much security here. Okay, so again, so we have quite a few patients, and actually the number of patients is further increasing because of the increasing age of the populations. And so again, the main therapy that we have is just simply giving the patients L-DOPA, which gets converted in the brain into dopamine. And dopamine is the neurotransmitter that those dopamine neurons, the 400,000 you should have, produce. And again, L-DOPA was really kind of a revolution 50 or 60 years ago. There were patients towards the mid or at high severity that were often nearly in a wheelchair, because eventually they couldn't walk at all. They could walk out of the wheelchair after L-DOPA. It was amazing. But then the problem is the amazing part doesn't really last. Typically, after 4 to 5 years, you start L-DOPA, the medication wears off, and you actually start getting side effects. And there are a number of reasons for that. One of the reasons is that L-DOPA still has to get converted and properly released by those remaining dopamine neurons. If you lose more and more, this function is going to be gone. And so again, so there's a number of reasons, obviously, why the increasing degeneration is really problematic, even if you have L-DOPA. And so what people then have tried to do is develop different therapies. One quite popular and used clinically now quite routinely is called deep brain stimulation. That's a therapy where you put a stimulator into the brain electrically, and you stimulate the region that's supposed to bypass the need of dopamine neurons. So it doesn't really replace dopamine, it doesn't stimulate dopamine. It tries to, by understanding basal ganglia circuits, to kind of circumvent the need for dopamine. And again, for certain symptoms that works quite well, for others it works less well, and it clearly, again, doesn't give you all dopaminergic function back. So therefore, it was then kind of always the question, if really you have a dopamine loss, you lost 200,000, you get the symptoms, why don't we just put them back? And again, I showed you the circle of all the different disease mechanisms, and again, sometimes I argue, so you can make the point, if you have a car that breaks down, let's say you lose, the tire breaks down, there can be many of those mechanisms that make your tire break. But you don't really care necessarily, you just put a new tire in. And so here's a bit the same idea. If you can put in new dopamine neurons back in that at least not going to get immediately affected by the disease again, then it's basically a very simplistic strategy, but it might just work. And so this idea has been around for a long time. In the late 80s, basically started with using fetal cells at that time. And so this is a human fetus, about 8.5 weeks post-conception. And what you can see here is that a piece ventrally is cut out, which is then suspended into a single cell suspension, injected into the brain of patients, and you get basically the surviving grafts. So this brown stuff is all tyrosine hydroxylase staining, and you can see that's quite a lot of those cells that survived in a patient that came afterwards to autopsy. And you can also measure actual dopamine production in the brain. This is a so-called fluorodopa PET imaging system, where you can measure basically dopamine production by those cells in a live patient. Now, this has been done in quite a few patients, actually, at the time. More than 300 patients were grafted. And if you look at all those data, you will find that the benefit was kind of variable. And the initial studies looked quite promising, but they were not really fully controlled. When they did second set of placebo-controlled studies, they were kind of largely borderline, or in some cases even failing. Furthermore, some patients had unexpected side effects, so-called graft-induced dyskinesia. So meaning in this case, dyskinesia is an uncontrolled movement. So when you then take, when the disease advances, and you basically give L-DOPA, and it gets no longer properly converted into dopamine neurons, but just dumped on the synapse, you get basically these overshooting, uncontrollable responses. And so that was clearly not good news, so not very effective, and unexpected side effects. Now, in hindsight, actually, it turned out there were a number of reasons. One reason was that the patients they used for the placebo-controlled study were way too severe. They were actually at the stage where the cells receiving dopamine already started to degenerate. Furthermore, they basically just simply didn't wait long enough. It turns out the therapy works very slowly. The cells have to mature for a very protracted period. And if you had taken as an endpoint 24 months, the trials would have been highly successful. And on the other one was, it's basically, again, patient selection. That's really important. Nevertheless, the reason why people got, again, very interested in that is actually that patients were still followed, even though it was no longer a controlled study. Some of those patients were now followed for something like 15 years. That's a very long time in a chronic neurodegenerative disease. And what they found is at least a subset of those patients, they seem to have nearly completely basically recovered from their motor symptoms after 15 years, meaning they were off L-DOPA medication. Not only did L-DOPA medication no longer not work, now that's usually what happens, it works and then doesn't work anymore, but they actually didn't even need it anymore. So that was quite remarkable. It was only about 25 to 30% of the patient, but still that can't be by chance because it never happens in Parkinson's otherwise. So the question then was really, can we get that result more consistently and how do we do that? And I think most people agree that probably to do that, you can no longer use fetal tissue because there's already inherent variability in that tissue. Because fetal tissue, what it means is you get aborted tissue from different ages, different genetic background, and so forth. And so it's impossible to standardize. So therefore, the promise really of doing that with stem cells is that you have now a renewable source, and you would have then the idea of really replacing function long-term. And again, it's always a bit difficult to talk about the cure because it's not really going to be a cure of Parkinson's disease. Because I told you before, Parkinson's is not just dopamine neurons. But the best case scenario would be that's a cure of the motor symptoms permanently. So that's kind of the goal. And what we hope is, again, that the cells might have benefits beyond just secreting dopamine because they actually synaptically connect. And this connectivity seems to help restoring or retaining the circuit. Because I told you before that actually in late patients what happens is even the receiving cells start degenerating. So that obviously is a problem. But the idea is, and you can show it in animal studies, if you actually retain innervation, you can also block that degeneration. Furthermore, you would have then really a therapy that's maybe quite attractive. You would have a one-time surgery, and then that should be it. And therefore, if you can make it basically at large scale, maybe it could even be quite cost-effective. And again, the idea has been around for a long, long time. Now, the path to really to get there was also very long. And again, just for fun, I put actually this picture in, where I was about your age, or a little bit younger, not necessarily because of my most beautiful haircut there, but because, just to see how long this stuff takes, actually. So that was, again, in the early 90s, where I did that. I was actually an MD student at the time and worked with this guy, which is a young neurosurgeon, and we were crazy enough at the time to actually make, the, again, first such fetal tissue trial back in Switzerland. Went all the way from getting from our neurosurgery department a broom closet that we could use for our preparation to actually then eventually putting something into patients. Now, again, it was clear to me during that whole process that fetal tissue is clearly not the way to go because it's an absolute nightmare, you know, to get the tissue to prepare, to QC, and you cannot really properly QC. You don't have the time. You dissect, put it in. So then he went really on a long search for me, but how are we going to make a better source? And initially when I went as a postdoc, really the idea was, you have to use neural stem cell because obviously dopamine neurons are neurons, so they come from nervous system, they take neural stem cells. And so we actually were able to take neuroprecursors coming from the midbrain region, this is BRDO labeling, actually. So long-term BRDO labeling, you could label all the precursors and show at a given stage that you could expand them and then make them into dopamine neurons, because obviously neurons never are BRDO positive when you label them, so they must come from the BRDO precursor. So that was nice, but then actually when I got my own lab, was kind of the question, am I going to push that further and take it to the clinic, or maybe switch to something else? And I decided to switch to something else, because with these cells, you are still limited to actually having initially human fetal tissue. You can expand it, but only to a limited extent. And already when I was, again, as a postdoc, we started actually working on mouse embryonic stem cells. And that was like the late 90s, and we were able to show, finally, that we can use developmental principles at hedgehog, FGF8, and so forth, and take either mouse ear cells. We also used so-called nuclear transfer ear cells by cloning, like a dolly-like technique, make the match that was pre-Yamanaka, or even partenogenetic cells, and we could show, make dopamine neurons, put them into an animal, the animal recovers, we're very excited. So you would think, that's like 2000, 2003, so why are we still not having a therapy, you know, if this worked so well? And really where the big bottleneck was actually translating it to the human, surprisingly. And so initially we thought that should all work. We had a couple of years later, a nice paper showed that you make this engrail positive cell, that's a marker of the midbrain. We made this dopaminergic marker positive. They were at least electrophysiologically active, secreting dopamine, evoked, and so they had synapses. This immunogold labeling of TH looked reasonable. But the big problem was when you inject them in vivo, we had these horrible grafts. So the word is GFP, they were GFP labeled. The cells seemed to survive, but the dopamine neurons seemed to be not survive or disappear. And that really got us then kind of on a nearly 10-year search, you know, how do you fix that? And we tried many, many things. And again, I'm not going to bore you with all the what I think are actually failed papers, even though they were sometimes published in reasonable journals. But so what was the problem is not only did we not make the right cell, we actually caused overgrowth. And so you can obviously ask, you talk about regenerative medicine, what's the risk? Everyone talks about the risk of teratoma formation, not that you're going to get teratomas, and that's the problem. We actually never see teratomas in our system. Never. We still have to test it. I'll come back to that in a minute. It costs several $1 million to actually prove that. But we actually never see them. But what we saw initially is this overgrowth. And again, we are here in a meeting which is very interesting, organoids. It's basically an organoid in vivo that continues growing, no? So basically put these cells in, contaminating with cortical neuroepithelial precursors, they grow. They actually ignore more or less the environment. And even if you have contamination 5, 10% of those cells, they can make very large structures. They are not transformed, they are not a classic cancer. They eventually stop growing, but they cause a big mess. What really solved it then was again developmental biology. So we figured out actually that we shouldn't really just take a neural precursor and then pattern it towards dopamine neuron. What we had to figure out is actually that these cells, if you do fate mapping, they come specifically not from the classic neural tube, they come from the floor plate itself. The floor plate is normally considered just a signaling center that produces hedgehog. You might have heard the beautiful work of Tom Chestel. Now you have hedgehog here, patterns the motor neurons on the side. That's what he thought is the same in the midbrain, but actually it's different. So in the midbrain, you also have hedgehog produced here. It also patterns many of the neurons, like the midbrain motor neurons, exactly the Chestel model. But the dopamine neurons itself, themselves, they actually come from the floor plate itself. So the floor plate becomes neurogenic. And so then once we figured that out, we got basically this FOXA2, which is a floor plate marker, as a way to know that we make now the right cells. And we then could do that quite effectively, and again showed how these cells work. You can make them at high purity and so forth. But really the key thing was not to show that this works in vitro, but it works in vivo. And that was kind of the biggest challenge. And for us, that was really then the breakthrough at the time, you know, after again 10 years of trying, that we had now a cell that came through this floor plate intermediate, but most importantly would survive in a mouse, in a rat, or in a monkey model of Parkinson's disease, and lead to behavioral recovery in those models. And you can actually do that at pretty high efficiency. If you paid attention to my numbers, I told you about 400,000 in a human brain. This is already 100,000 on each side of a monkey brain. And these are much, much smaller monkeys. The monkey brain is about 5 times smaller than the human brain here. And you can see that you can easily make, again, numbers that would be clinically meaningful to survive. These are human ES-derived dopamine neurons in a monkey brain. And so then again, we had to do many, many tests to show how do they function. Just to give you a flavor of some of those assays, you have these crazy rotation assays. So the way they work is that you lesion the animal on one side, you wipe out the dopaminergic system, the substantia nigra neurons, and then you have only dopamine innervation on one side left. And normally the animals are pretty normal, but if you stimulate them with amphetamine, they start turning around their own axis. Now they don't turn really that fast, so this is a sped up movie, but still they turn actually quite fast. And so then if you graft them, they hopefully stop turning. And that's another such assay where you look at kind of four limb use, that the animal can basically support its weight. And you see on the left paw, it cannot really do that. But then after 4 months, it can again support its weight. And the reason is not because the animal is paralyzed and then recovers. It can actually not properly initiate movements. And that's very similar to Parkinson's patients. Again, at the time when James Parkin was in London, there were no red lights yet. But if you now go to the great cities and look at basically how people cross the street, Parkinson's patients, they have exactly this problem. When it turns from red to green, they basically, when it turns green, they try to initiate and they cannot initiate. And then suddenly they make a few steps. But they have a lot of problems with initiation. And that's the same in those animals. They cannot properly initiate.
Yeah? Why do you consider this associated amount to be better for the cell therapy? Can you compare it to an alpha-synuclein injection that
it gets? Yeah, I mean, so far it has been basically a simple model. I think alpha-synuclein injection, like basically directly into the substantia nigra, that you could potentially do, because then you get selective loss in the dopamine neurons. But in either case, it's just a dopamine loss model. I mean, basically what you try to achieve is dopamine loss. And obviously alpha-synuclein disease generally is much broader than just dopamine neurons. This would be a model that you could try. All the other genetic models have usually the issue that they don't cause dopaminergic loss. It's not a progressive model, it's a complete loss model. No, I mean, I agree, it's definitely another model you could try. The problem is, then again, if it's too progressive, depending on how much you inject, then you might also get secondary effects. So with regard to, like, do you really slow down how the cells cope with alpha-synuclein and die, or is it really a true replacement? I agree this is a completely artificial model, but it's a very clean model, no? The idea is once the cells are lost, you put them back. And the nice thing, and I didn't really stress that too much in this case, is you actually know that in a real patient, whatever the disease is, we know that cells can survive, assuming they are similar to the fetal cells. And so whatever the toxic environment is going to be in an actual patient, which is obviously very, very different than a 6-hydroxydopamine model, we think we have a pretty good chance that the cells are going to survive if they are comparable to the fetal cells. Yeah. Great. So the other thing we really tried to check here is, now all these assays, you know, the rotation assays and all these other assays, they are all correlative assays. So you put the cells in, then the animal improves, and you obviously assume that the cells caused improvement. But just as I mentioned before with alpha-synuclein, maybe our cells would rescue some cells that would otherwise die with 6-hydroxydopamine, or maybe they would attract some fibers from other regions. So how do we really know how the graft truly works? And so we did this experiment here using optogenetics that's actually quite neat to show that, where you have now the option that you can basically put an optogenetic switch, which basically I don't have the scheme here actually, but in this case it's basically a halorhodopsin, so it's a chloride, modified light-sensitive chloride channel, that actually when you shine light on the neuron, it stops firing. It doesn't do anything, it doesn't kill the cell, it just stops firing. And so what you can now do is, again, put that in your cell, specific cell, you could make it promoter-specific, whatever you want, and then test what that does either in vitro or in vivo, and you can do that in a freely moving animal. And so to just give you one flavor here, what we did in this study is that we now tested yet another behavioral assay, which is called the corridor assay. Again, the same model, you have dopamine wiped out on one side of the brain, the animal is asymmetrically Parkinsonian. And what that means in this assay is the animal is hungry and eats food pellets. But actually, when it's Parkinsonian, it's going to ignore the food pellet's contralateral deletion. And that's what the neurologists call like a hemineglect. So it's, again, it's not paralyzed, it kind of just ignores it. And a wild-type animal, in contrast, shown here, does it nicely 50-50. You can take a wild-type animal, normally shine light with the control, with the laser, still 50-50. And again, that's how it looks if you have a lesioned animal. It's highly, highly lateralized. And you can do some pharmacological trick where you actually change the polarity. If you're interested, I can go into that. But again, it's more like an assay to kind of tweak the system. But anyway, so the point is that this was an assay that indeed now can be yet again restored. So meaning if we now graft our cells, they go back to 50-50. It takes about 4 to 5 months. They have human estrived dopamine neurons. The animal seems to pretty much completely recover. So that's nice. But the real reason why we did this experiment is now to see what happens if you now have such an animal grafted for 5 months or so, but now you're going to use this optogenetic switch. So you shine light into the walking animal as it does this assay and see, is it now going to basically have an effect? And the prediction is now if you shut off activity just of the dopamine neurons, the whole host cells are all the same, you can test whether activity of the grafted cells is necessary for that behavioral improvement. And if you do that, so you pull the switch, you see that it's again as sick as it was basically 5 or 6 months before. So what that means is that the behavior recovery is completely dependent on constant activity of those neurons. So it's not just anything indirect, it's not just trophic factors, it's actual activity of the neurons. And you can then show pharmacologic, it's actually activity-dependent dopamine release. Now what this assay doesn't really show yet is that it's actually connectivity. It just says it's activity and it's dopamine release. But we actually went even one step further where we showed that there is actual connectivity. And you can do that in this six slice preps of those animals. So again, 6 months old animals. You make these very sick slices acutely. And now you can stimulate incoming afferents that come in from the thalamus or the cortex here. They innervate medium spiny neurons here, blue and red in the striatum. So that's the normal striatal circuit. And that's the circuit that dopamine neurons need to modulate. That's the function. So they either modulate D1 or D2 medium spiny neurons here in blue and red. And so you can now ask where they actually can do that. And so again, you stimulate here, you record from here, but now the twist is that you do that either in the absence or presence of light. So meaning if you now stimulate here, you record here, but then you switch on the light, then you switch off the dopamine neurons. And so the way that looks is shown here. Maybe this is the easiest one to understand. So here you see basically the strengths of the synaptic connections, an EPSP coming from this input onto the medium spiny neuron. And as soon as you switch on the light, you see you lose about 40% of the amplitude. So that's the modulatory function of those human grafted dopamine neurons. And then if you switch the light again off, they go back to control. And so that's kind of neat because you have indeed now a system where you can show that indeed they seem to connect with this proper synaptic target and seem to modulate it in a way very similar to their endogenous dopamine neurons. We even did more pharmacology. You can see that it's D1, D2 dependent and so forth. But so that was really then the time. Now we said, okay, we really, I think, understand enough to really think, can we make that into an actual regenerative medicine, not just for mice, no, but actually for humans. So that led then to another long pass, nearly another 10 years, from our 2011 paper to really now moving forward towards the clinic. And so one really important thing, it's maybe obvious, but maybe not so obvious if you don't have it, is really that you need to have money for doing that. So it's actually very expensive. So we were fortunate that the state at that time was very interested in supporting regenerative medicine, so we got $15 million to really over 4 or 5 years to move that towards the clinic. And then you need to go through all those various stages. I will just mention a few of them, but obviously you need to figure out how to even do that now, because nobody has actually done that before with those pluripotent-derived neurons in general. And then you need to be able to manufacture those cells, need to actually produce the cells you're going to put into the patient, and then you need to test them yet again, and then you need to obviously submit all your documents to the regulatory agencies, which is the FDA in the US. Now, one important step was, again, to have a good protocol, and I'll come back to that in a minute, because what was important is that we need to do that now under so-called clinical-grade conditions. So meaning you can no longer do that in my lab, which is clearly not a GMP lab. People come in from the street now, and there's maybe some stuff, we try to keep it as clean as possible, but it's clearly not GMP. And so we were fortunate at Sloan Kettering that we actually had a brand new such facility that by itself cost, again, $50 or $100 million. And you can here make up to 16 different products in parallel, clinical grade products. For example, it's currently being used quite heavily for this cancer therapy, the so-called CAR T cell therapy that goes into patients quite routinely. And so what we did is we could basically rent those two rooms and really manufacture our cells there. And by we, I mean, it's actually Mark Tomishima, who's the guy who was a former postdoc of mine. And then he ran actually the core facility for many years. And then he got really excited with this project and actually himself got trained to go into the GMP facility. And with his team then actually produced those cells. But again, I jumped a little bit ahead because what we had to first do is actually developing the protocol. And again, just for you guys, for the guys of you who are interested in dopamine neurons, I put a few slides in. For the other ones, you might be able to sleep a little bit. But so it basically has to do with markers, to get the right markers in those cells. And that actually was, again, more difficult than I thought, because again, we said, oh, we are the guys have developed all these protocols, no problem. But actually, it was quite challenging. And what happened is that some of the markers that we relied on, the floor plate marker, another marker called LMX1A, they were always fine. So GMP version, non-GMP were always fine. But other markers such as PAK6 started to shift. And this is a scale, which is called the CT threshold. So actually lower levels is higher expression. So the cells started to express some PAK6, and they start expressing lower TH and lower NOR1. And so it took us quite a long time before we could restore, actually do that, to get at least the markers again right. And even get some other markers that were chronically variable, like engrailed, much more consistent. And because it's not published, I tell you just a little bit how that works. So it's actually what you call a wind boost protocol. So some of you might know that many of those protocols rely a lot on a compound, which is GSK3 inhibitor, that depending on which concentration you expose your pluripotent cells to, gives you either from forebrain all the way to lumbar spinal cord. And what we find is that you have a concentration that's best for the midbrain. The problem with that is, do the experiment 5 times, every time it shifts a little bit. Once it's 0.7, once it's 1, once it's 0.6. So it's kind of a nightmare for manufacturing. And so what we found is actually, if you take the concentration which you think is right, but then slightly later, you boost the concentration about 5 times, in some cases up to 10 times higher, we get a much more stable phenotype. And what we think happens is that first you specify the midbrain region, called this hindbrain midbrain region, but then within this region you have here in pink, WNT1 expressed, and it's only expressed on the midbrain, not on the hindbrain. And this is very, very highly expressed, actually dopamine neurons themselves to become WNT1 positive. And we think we captured that stage. And what that does is, in a dose-dependent manner, just this boost increases engrailed quite dramatically. And this now became now a marker that we routinely have to test for our clinical protocol. And you can show it's only the boost that does it, shown here. So this is like the standard protocols that we published, other labs have published, 0.7, you get very little. But then if you boost it, you get a lot. If you say, okay, I'm just going to add more cheer all the time, you don't get it at all. So it's, the timing is extremely crucial. And we think actually it has to do again with fine-tuning the midbrain region, and you can probably do it with other factors like FGF8, which is a paper actually published by Marlene Palmer recently. But with FGF8, there's certain risks that we see. If you caudalize the cells more back with FGF8 to get higher engrail levels, that we actually get sometimes contaminating cells that are basically non-CNS cells, which obviously is also quite dangerous. So what we'd also showed is actually that this is really indeed, at least in part, dependent on this engrailed gene. So you can take now this boost protocol, but do it now either in a wild-type cell line, like we always do, or in a cell line where we knocked out the engrailed gene, to see is this just a marker engrailed that we can now use for clinical development, or is actually not only a marker but essential. And what you find is that if you knock out engrailed, even with the best protocol, you drop some of the key markers quite significantly. They're not completely gone, but they are much, much worse. So again, with this new WNT boost protocol, this is now a really nice platform. You can make pretty highly enriched neurons. You can make them very mature, way beyond of when you would want to graft them. And you can get, again, a lot of those cells positive. And for fun, I actually put in this picture. So what you might see here, can you guys hopefully see it? So that's when you spin down the cells. You actually get a black pellet. Can you guess why? It's basically neuromelanin that you actually get. So it's kind of cool. No, it's kind of a, an interesting bioassay in ovarian pigment itself tells you that you must have substantia nigra neurons. And so you can now do that quite routinely. It doesn't happen at the time when you want to graft the cells because it's way later, but it's still a nice feature to kind of get you an idea that actually.
So this happened after how many weeks or what day?
So initially that was, I think, day 90 or so, but we have now some tricks where we can induce it reliably about day 50 or day 60.
Usually in vivo it's postnatal in humans.
Exactly. It's actually, we use it, we have again, fortunately probably not going to get to that part, but you're very interested in trying to induce maturation in neurons or aging. And so that was always a marker we used when we expressed progerin. That was a paper we published before. We actually got some, we got some neuromelanin, but otherwise we couldn't get it. And so now I think we have again, we have some other aging strategies where again we can get it now by about day 50, day 60. But this is without major aging strategy. They're just basically getting more enriched substantia nigra neurons, and I guess they age somewhat in addition to simply growing on plastic. And again, it's also a little bit cheating, you can argue, because I mean, if you really know what neuromelanin is, it's basically dopamine that's oxidized. It's actually not completely true because it has to do one more step. So, but it requires those two facts. You need to have enough dopamine, and you need enough oxidative basically factors to really get there.
I guess that's an important point, because at one point we can discuss there are multiple ways in which you can get black pigment during brain development. And I'm sure some of you have done, brain organoids may have seen black dots. Mm-hmm. So maybe we can discuss at one point the sources of the black dot, because there are at least four that I can think of. And this is one, obviously.
That's just, we did also quite a bit of electrophysiology. By we, I mean actually the lab of Dave Salzer and Eugene Mozharoff at Columbia. And again, we don't need to go through that, but we have all the kind of the various characteristics that people have described and subtypes of dopamine neurons. And they also show basically robust dopamine release. But the point is, that's again kind of, we had to kind of go back and re-optimize the protocol, now with GMP reagents. But then once you have done that, that's kind of the, you can call it the fun part, now where you kind of try to apply the developmental biology. And then comes more kind of the boring part, but which is very, very important, which I want to show you a little bit too, which is basically you have to do it again and again and again and again. And so what we did at that time is basically we had to have a panel of something like 45 markers that we developed, where you then show that you can reproducibly go through that step, and you pretty much get all the time the same differentiation behavior. And doing that initially, not yet in the GMP facility because that's too expensive, but do it in a kind of a reasonably clean lab, and then show that you're ready for really actual manufacturing at very large scale. And yeah, we don't need to go through all of that. And again, just to give you a little bit more of the kind of the painful flavor here. So when you then actually start developing that, you need to do so-called SOPs. This basically stands for standard operating procedure. And again, if you guys talk about QC in organoids or whatever, that's what we mean by true QC. That means you need to completely describe every single step you do, every single way, every pipette thing you're going to use needs to be described, and how much you triturate, everything needs to be described in great detail. In this case, there were 86 different SOPs. Not only do you need to describe it in great detail, but then actually you need to be trained on each of the SOPs and certified. So it's a lot of work. And I cannot tell you how surprised I was as a PI when I tried to figure out, like when we, again, going back to this Wnt-Pusch protocol, when we started developing the GMP protocol, it was quite remarkable, actually, how the protocol within the lab started to drift. Now you think, you described and published the protocol, everyone would do the same thing. But actually, they kind of started doing small tweaks, and, you know, and at the end, pretty much everyone had a slightly different version of the protocol. You were convinced that it's better. But actually, it probably was not better, and it was a kind of a big mess. No? And so that's, I think, with tissue culture, is often people are very superstitious because it worked once, and then they do it again and again. But so what you really need to do, because FDA doesn't care about superstition, you really have to show how to do it consistently and again and again. And again, this is not such a tidbit, no, that if you actually now start producing the cells in the GMP facility, you need to think about every detail. And that's one such detail. You can no longer use regular paper. You need to have a paper that doesn't make any dust. Now you have to type it on a computer, but you also have to type it on paper, and this is a special paper that doesn't cause any dust in the facility. So again, the details matter. But then again, so with Mark's team, we actually went through all those steps, and in late 2016, actually, we started producing those lots with this Wnt-Pusch protocol. And by producing the lots, I mean a lot of lots. a lot of cells. So it's about 10 billion of those dopamine neurons we produced. And we think the way we calculate currently, this is about equivalent theoretically what you would need for about 1,000 people. Now that's obviously a lot of people. We're not going to treat 1,000 people with those lots. But we wanted to show that we can do that consistently. So we had to have 4 independent lots to show that we can do that again and again. And we had to have very specific release criteria. And there it's again, you cannot just kind of look at the cells and say, oh, looks good, I have enough TH, a lot of this. You actually need to pre-specify, and you say exactly, so how many cells do I need to have before I can release it? And obviously then, how do you know? So it's actually, it's a tricky thing. Now, in theory, with the regulatory agency, you need to justify each marker. How do you know this is the right marker? How do you know it's good enough? And so it's a lot of thinking, a lot of work, and also, unfortunately, still quite a bit of guessing, you know, because nobody knows, really. And so you need to have a lot of in vivo feedback, transplantation data, and so forth, to really get an idea of what are your release criteria. And we basically have 7 different release criteria to really do that. And again, we did then 4 independent such production runs to actually make those cells. And again, unfortunately, I forgot to put in this one slide, but it kind of looks funny if you see all the release criteria, all the lot production. It looks basically, I compare it to like what you have in a complicated medication. You get these sheets in the medication, but you have all this acetaminophen, there is this and this. So basically you need to describe all those, like there's so much FOXA2, there's so much percentage of that. It's basically like a drug product at that stage. And even the vial is actually prescribed. You need to know exactly how to vial the cells, what you describe on it, what's the product description. And then what we had to do, obviously, if you make so many cells, there's no point of making those cells if you cannot store them. And these are young kind of neuroprogenitus neurons, so that was not completely trivial when we started off. We didn't really know, can we actually freeze the cells? But eventually, we were reasonably good at doing that, so we get about 80 or close to 90% viability after freezing and then thawing. And importantly, when you look at this curve, it actually stays pretty much flat up to about 8, nearly 24 hours on ice. So the reason why that's important is once you thaw the cells in a GMP facility, then the cells are going to go to the OR, nowhere for the surgery, and then the surgery can take a couple of hours. And so you don't really want to have the cells now suddenly starting crashing now during that time. And so that was, again, a very important feature, you know, that you can really show that you can do that. And it's the idea that you have a true off-the-shelf product, you know, that's what they call it. And therefore, you also need to show basically the shelf lifetime of the product. Here I have you shown the data up to 12 months to show that the viability doesn't go down. By now, we actually have up to 18 months or 24 months. We have kind of we call it the canary in the coal mine. So we had a few lots that he produced ahead of the clinical lots, to see that they remain stable even over long periods of time so that you can use them. Now a lot that's produced somewhere in fall of 2016 is going to be the lot that you want to put into patients in late 2018. And so this gives you a few more pictures how these cells actually look. So this is marker FOXA2 in red and tyrosine hydroxylase in green, and that's at day 21, which actually is slightly later when we graft, because by the time we graft, you still have a relatively low percentage of TH. But we have as a QC to show that they turn into TH after replating 5 days later. Then again, these are many of those markers. And for example, just to give you one flavor, for some markers, it's nearly pure, which is this FOXA2 marker. It's basically now by 99% purity for that specific marker. And FOXA2 is again a marker in the floor plate, in the endoderm, but it's not so commonly expressed in the brain otherwise. So it gives you already a much more restricted population, and obviously it's expressed both in the progenitors and in the postmitotic dopamine neurons. Now, equally important is not only to show that you have reasonably pure cells with regard to the positive markers, but you also have to show that you don't have the negative markers. And again, that's what the regulatory agents are most worried about, which is the risk of teratoma formation. And so we have multiple assays. I don't think I have show you many of them. I just show you here one at least. And the way that works is now that you try to develop we test many, many different primers, many different genes. You find the most sensitive primers to show that you can now obviously distinguish our product from, our product is up here, compared to basically pluripotent stem cells. And then what you do is you spike in 1%, 0.1%, and so forth, pluripotent cells into your dopaminergic neurons, and show that you can still detect it. And what you can find is that you can detect it at least up to about roughly 1 in a million or so. So that's about the level of sensitivity. And again, our cells are not different with regard to OCT4 expression from fibroblasts or anything, all else a primary cell, but any assay has a limit of detection. And so that's still a little bit of a problem, because then you can say, okay, you can show me one in 100,000, one in a million. So what are you going to do? Now you're going to graft more than a million cells. How do you know it's not zero? And so there's a big discussion among different regulatory agencies. What do you have to do? And I think I'll come back to that in a minute, but what they in the US at least still have you to do is long-term in vivo studies. But before I get there, obviously equally important, looking again contaminating cells here, is can you show that the cells still work? Because now you went through this large production, you go through freezing, thawing, and so forth. So do these cells actually still work? And so that we were quite happy to see, you know, that you can now take such cells, thaw them, basically engraft them, and you see here again in brown all this tyrosine hydroxylase expression, and you see these fibers projecting to the periphery. You see the rotation assay completely restored. And again, what I particularly stress here is these fibers. So these are no cell bodies here. These are just dopaminergic fibers. This is a human-specific marker. And this is the dopamine marker. And this is the overlay. And this is far away from the graft core where you have cell bodies. So the reason why that's important is because obviously compared to a mouse or a rat or even to a monkey, the human stratum is much, much larger. So meaning the cells have to project over very large distances to have a chance to really work well. And so that was a very important step. Now again, the next issue then is really the question, can we now really move forward with it? And the way that works, at least in the US, is now you have multiple meetings with regulatory agencies. The very first meeting was for us to simply to agree we're actually going to use our first trial, use a legacy human ear cell line. Can you do that? Now, can you use a human ear cell line that was derived a long time ago? And we got pretty much the okay after doing additional testing. Then there's a second meeting, which is called pre-IND meeting, where they were particularly interested in our manufacturing. So you need to show them every single of your SOPs. You need to show them all the reagents, everything. And they give you then feedback whether that's acceptable. And pretty much everything was acceptable, which is obviously very good. And they also told us that we didn't need to do any additional large animal studies for the actual final step. And also they were okay with our phase one clinical trial plans. They wanted us to do more testing of the device that we're going to use to inject into the brain. But really the biggest challenge was at that stage, again, it was in 2016, is we needed to do a lot of in vivo studies again. Not necessarily monkey studies, even though we did one of that, but we needed to do basically safety studies. And what that means is you have basically so-called tumorigenicity study. That's a teratoma thing. You need to actually in vivo spike in percentages of human pluripotent stem cells and see whether you can detect them in vivo. Show at what level of spiking in human pluripotent stem cells would you get a tumor. In our case, it's about between 0.1 to 1% you can cause a teratoma. And then you need to show that you can make several dilutions below that you don't get tumors. And then you need to show that your assay is even several logs below that. So that's kind of the way they think. So this was a lot of work and a lot of cost, because you cannot even do it in your own lab or in your own institution. You have to do it with an independent contract research organization that's specialized. So the idea is you cannot really kind of massage the data or present them in a nice way or whatever. So it's going to be hardcore. They present basically the way it comes out. And the problem was actually that there was no CRO that has expertise in doing stereotactic surgery. So we actually had to send six of our people basically to Minnesota. If you guys in the US at least know, that's maybe not the most friendly place in the middle of winter. But so they basically went there and had to basically for 2 weeks, they did nothing else. They're basically grafting about, it was nearly 450, I think, mice. And they were basically unlesioned mice, NSG mice. So this is the most immune compromised strain that's used for tumor injections. So the immune system doesn't work at all. So if anything grows, it's going to grow. And again, luckily, I have to say this is now all completed, and we all got basically a clear sign from all those studies. And also, again, maybe just to, if you're another thing, actually, you also need is biodistribution and toxicology. So biodistribution means basically where do the cells go? Would they suddenly get into the bloodstream and end up somewhere else? Or toxicology comes actually from the drug industry, which doesn't make so much sense with those cells, but you still have to do it. Is maybe do you cause liver toxicity by injecting cells in the brain? It's very unlikely, but you have to do it. And so similarly, then we had to do an efficacy study, which we had to do, could actually do at Sloan Kettering, that one, and then another surgical device testing, which we did in the monkey. And this just shows you the actual data, for example, now with the, if you go back, from the actual clinical lots. So you can see that they again completely recovered both in male and in female rat hosts. And basically that, so basically and these are the exact same lot, not the exact same clinical lot that should go now into patients. Now what we then do in the patient is shown here. So the way it's designed is gonna be, what I mentioned before, a phase one study primarily. For the specialists or wannabe specialists, it's actually called phase one, 2A. That means it's the primary goal is just safety, but we're gonna look for signs of efficacy. And so what you then have there is, in this case, 10 patients, and there are certain criteria. They're about kind of mid-stage of disease, mid-stage to severe. We can, if you guys want, happy to discuss that. Now, there's actually an ethical discussion on that. Should you give that to patients that are very severe? Should you give it to relatively early stage patients, a first in human trial? Who has the best risk-benefit ratio? And so that's an interesting discussion by itself. And so we went to patients that, it's also kind of funny actually, that if you, because people always ask me, so are they severe patients, moderate patients, mild patients? And the answer is actually that if you talk to a neurosurgeon, they are severe. If you talk to a neurologist, they are moderate. But they're the same patients. And so the reason is because the neurosurgeons, they think they are severe because they need now a surgical treatment like DBS. The neurologists think they are moderate because they can still tweak their medications and so forth. But anyway, so the medication is no longer optimal at that stage. And so you hope again to give something that you also can measure. There's also a practical implication. Let's say even if you were allowed to go to very early stage patient, I think the therapy likely would work best there. You might never have to take L-DOPA. The problem then is, think about the timeline. So you're gonna graft the patient now, usually the patient is okay for 5 years, there's very little medication. So how would you know that this thing works now? So you have to, there's many, many considerations that you have to do, both ethical, practically, actually had to work with ethicists, with clinical trialists and so forth. Came up with this kind of, I guess, intermediate stage. We're gonna test two doses, and those doses are actually based on those numbers that I mentioned to you before. So they range from 50,000 new dopamine neurons to 150,000. We might actually be slightly higher than that. But so we think this is enough, based on the fetal grafts, to get again over the bump that you should have a major improvement, and maybe even again sustained improvement for the rest of the patient's life. The cell's gonna be injected in a single session, both sides of the brain. And if you can see, this is actually a movie if you look carefully, because this is a surgery done under MRI guidance, where you can see basically, in this case, a drug injected. So we haven't really started the trial, but this is the same device that's used clinically for injecting drugs. And you can see obviously very nicely that you place it exactly at the right place. But even more importantly, you can see that it don't cause any problems. You can imagine if you graft the patient on both sides of the brain, you do 3 tracts each. Each tract could cause bleeding. If you cause major bleeding on one side of the brain, you probably shouldn't go to the other side, because obviously that would be a big risk. And so the FDA only allowed us to do both sessions in one shot because we really had this MRI system where you would immediately see if there is any bleeding caused. And so I think that was again an advantage of that system. And we also have basically an allogenic cell. So it's a standard human ear cell lines. And so patients are gonna get transiently immune suppressed. And again, that's again a whole topic that I could discuss for a long time. Do you even need immune suppression in the brain? The brain is so-called partially immune privileged, and it's not a complete privilege by far, but it's good enough that typically allografts do survive. So there were some fetal graft patients that had never immune suppression ever, and 20 years later they still had a graft. However, if you look at the size of the graft and the number of surviving dopamine neurons, typically they seem to be fewer, and they also get a more chronic microglial response without immune suppression. So we think the best compromise is, again, giving them transient immune suppression. And the long-term plan is actually slightly different, which I'm happy to discuss as well. It has to do with this line here. Again, nearly 10 years after this line, once we actually had the protocol, we're getting now to the stage now from getting the money to the pre-IND, where we actually just about in August 4th is the deadline now where we're gonna file the IND. So we already filed so-called IRB with our clinical groups at the three hospitals. They are under review, and if everything goes as expected by September, early September, we should have the permission to actually start the clinical trial. And again, in this case, again, it's actually quite important to have enough resources. And the reason why I haven't been on this meeting the last few days is because I was in Basel talking to with a company that we actually started called Blue Rock Therapeutics that basically now sponsors that trial. And I have to warn you that I'm a co-founder of this company, so you don't believe, maybe you don't need to believe anything that I said now. But anyway, so I'm a consultant and have IP equity in this company. And again, they raised a lot of money to really make that feasible, that we can now take that to the clinic and hopefully make it feasible to get some of those other cells. Now I showed you this tree, some of other cell types forward towards the clinic. And so at this stage, again, we are kind of in this final administrative steps where we try to really iron out all the permissions and hope to start very soon. Now, even so, again, we started to engage with commercial companies or startup companies. There is also still an academic collaborative effort happening. So that means that there are groups here in Europe with Malin Parmar and Roger Parker that do something very similar. And we actually have quite regular meetings with them. We formed so-called this G-Force PD meeting. We actually just had a meeting very recently in Lund. There's another group by Jun Takashi, who has an iPS-based therapy that's also hopefully moving forward very soon. And we basically also write like statement papers on various topics. For example, we wrote one just very recently on clinical trial design so that other groups that want to move forward have insights of kind of how the whole field thinks on that. So that really gets me kind of to the end of the Parkinson's part, which is kind of the conclusions here. We don't need to go through the details, but the point is now that after a very, very long time, I think we are now kind of excited to actually finally give the go-ahead and see where this therapy truly works. Now, I have a few slides that should just make it, again, a little bit more generic to kind of finish up the regenerative medicine part. And just, again, coming back to this tree to give you a little bit of a flavor of what else might eventually move along. And again, we can have also some questions afterwards, maybe. But so one story that we are kind of excited is the enteric nervous system, something you probably haven't heard much about. But actually, in your gut, you have as many neurons, people say even more neurons, than you have in your spinal cord. There's about 500 million or more. And they basically are important, obviously, for motility and so forth. And we figured out about 2 years ago now how to make those cells, not only how to make them, but how you can inject them, for example, in a mouse, into this proximal region of the colon, and then basically get them to migrate all the way down to the rectum. And we were actually able to show that this is sufficient to rescue a mouse model of Hirschsprung disease. So this is a model that actually is in kids, not super rare, but one in 5,000 kids has this disease where the enteric nervous system doesn't really migrate properly during development. And so we have now an effort where we actually test whether we can bring this technology also at least one step closer to the clinic. And so that might be another quite interesting idea. The even bolder thing, obviously, are think about cortical neurons now. And so I just put you up some of our protocols. I mean, some of them are still not published, but where we have now like hyperpure cortical neurons, and you can engraft those cells and get really very dense human networks being formed from those grafted cells. This is this iDisco clearing technique where you can follow the human cells very easily. And we also have pretty good interneuron protocols where you can now really think of how using those cells. With the excitatory neurons, I think it's still quite questionable. Now, what's the right indication for those, because it's obviously very, very difficult. There's so many different excitatory subtypes. What would you put in? Would they connect? But we at least experimentally test how far can you push this engraftment system. And then for inhibitory neurons, the kind of the situation clinically is more straightforward. In fact, I think Arnold is not yet here, but I mean, he actually started a company with this technology and ID, Neurona, that actually is now trying to treat seizure and pain with pluripotent-derived interneurons. These are also neurons that can reinduce plasticity windows. For example, the famous experiment now where you get cortical blindness. You close the eye during the critical period, you're blind. But actually, if you graft interneurons later past the critical period, some of those animals can see again. So it's quite a remarkable cell type. And again, the question is how to best use that. And it also has been proposed to call it as a mule, so they actually also can carry gene cargo, because this cell is one of the very few neurons that in the adult brain can actually migrate quite extensively. And then obviously oligodendrocytes is another interesting population that I think might move forward. And so my wife, actually, Vivian, she had a paper a couple of years ago to show that you can make oligodendrocytes quite effectively, remyelinate, in this case, the corpus callosum, and repair a model of radiation damage, where myelination is a major problem. But we're also considering, obviously, treatment of leukodystrophies particularly, more questionable whether you could also use in the context of MS. And again, we are not the only one thinking about oligodendrocytes. Obviously, there is Steve Goldman, who has this beautiful picture shown here, where he basically says that in some of those animals, he can get basically nearly all the oligodendrocytes replaced in a mouse model with human oligodendrocytes. So this brings another interesting issue, you know, which, if you have time, we can discuss as well, which is actually the role of things like cell competition in vivo, where you seem to be not only getting the cells surviving, but they actually outcompete, they kind of kill the endogenous cells, which is kind of an interesting feature, because usually that's what tumors do. But in this case, there's no clear sign of a tumor, but they seem to outcompete the mouse cells. And there are very interesting studies done by Hiro Nakaoshi and by other people showing that actually you can try to actually play with that and force competitive advantages and so forth. But I think I'm going to stop here at least with the regenerative part. And I don't know whether you guys have any questions to that before maybe I move to the next session. Otherwise, we can also do it at the end, obviously, or we can constantly, please. Feel free.
Yeah? Do you think there would be a clinical benefit to if you didn't use kind of the line that you established now of grafting neurons, but if people became their own donors so that you would actually use their cells and use those? Do you think that would make a difference? Especially because you're now immunosuppressing for a year. Do you think you could avoid that?
Yeah, no, that's an interesting discussion. And it has been initially proposed by the group in Japan to do it like that. They've shown in a monkey that you can do that, for example, with a patient PDIPS human ES cell line. And they didn't see a difference if it comes from a patient or from a control. And so I think you could do that. The problem, I think, is the more fundamental problem is if you do it currently, with the current regulation patient matched, it's just simply not affordable. And there is no very good regulatory path. Because just simply for making the cells, you basically need to have, for each patient, you need to have own GMP facility, you need to do extensive safety testing for each person. And so it would be, at least with current techniques, it would be only affordable for super rich people. And I think it still has this fundamental problem that yes, maybe you are okay short term, get pretty good recovery. I would still think the cells are likely more vulnerable. You believe that at least some genetic susceptibility to the patient. So I don't think personally it's an ideal approach, but I don't think it's a stupid approach. So if someone wants to try, it might be fine. The other approaches that people have said is you just take basically similar to blood groups, and you make HLA matched banks. And so you can do that with iPS cells. You can actually go to the blood banks to find those donors that would match the most people. And there's with Shinya Yamanaka, a big effort ongoing where they try to make enough stem cell lines that it would cover 80 or 90% of the Japanese population. But they basically announced this program about 2-3 years ago, and they're only about 10% in. So it seems to be not a very, and they actually did the easiest one first. And there's one line that covers 16% of the population. But it's actually also a difficult pass. And even if you have, let's say, 50 or 80 lines, that's only the start. From each of those lines, you have to make you billions of neurons, no? So it's kind of logistically a nightmare. So what we want to do with BlueRock, and where we actually have licensed technology, is we actually want to use universal cell technology. So what that means is you can actually modify using CRISPR or other techniques, basically the MHC complement of the cells, and you basically knock out beta-2 microglobulin, you basically knock out most of the MHC1 component, but then you have to re-express HLA-E or HLA-G, because otherwise they get killed by natural killer cells because they don't express anything. But that actually seems to work, at least in some models. There was a paper in Nature Biotech on that, a company called Universal Cell published it first. And we kind of have some modified versions of that. So that the idea is then you have basically one batch, you know, that you can use for everybody. So the cost should be the same as doing it with now whatever, a human ES cell line, but it should be obviating the need for any immune suppression. And I think in the brain, my feeling is it's likely going to work with regard to immunologic compatibility because they only express MHC1, and it's a very low level of immunogenicity to start with. The bigger concern, I guess, is if you guys know neuroscience very well, this beautiful work from Carla Schatz, for example, that if you knock out MHC, you get synaptic defects in some cases. And you actually get, and I just met her actually recently on a meeting at the Broad, and we discussed that a little bit, and Jack said, oh, you shouldn't worry, because if anything, you just don't prune enough. But in this case, probably it's not going to matter much. But anyway, we kind of need to actually show that these cell lines still work in that context. And we're actually going to test that. We already made dopamine neurons from these universal cells. And we're going to test whether they still work. And if they still work, I think that would be my favorite way to make it really a commercial clinical product in the future. So the patients don't need to go through this half a year or a year of immunosuppression. It's kind of a pain.
So Ryan, just a general question after this fantastic journey that took so many years. Of course, you are very well aware of the intense controversy in the US about the new right to try bill. Mm-hmm. So if you now go back to this history, do you think that there would have been any moment or step in which such a legal approach would have made things easier, or on the contrary, you fear that this new bill actually may sort of contaminate the field and create actually a more difficult situation for getting patients vaccinated? What's your stance on that?
I mean, for us, I don't think it would have changed anything, because I think we clearly wanted to have something we believe in. But I think this is, it's already the case. No, it's not an either or. I mean, so there are a number of trials which I didn't go into it that are a bunch of crazy people already doing things. No? There has been one person who did based on compassionate use, without naming, I'm not supposed to name names, a trial came from Boston and then to New York. There was basically an N of one of someone supposedly got an iPS-derived dopamine neuron. N of one, not a clinical trial, compassionate use. But it seems completely crazy. And again, I heard things that made my hairs going go up in a not so good way. And so I really think that's problematic. And then there's a trial actually happening now in Australia currently, which is also quite problematic. So they use partner genetic cells, and they claim they do dopamine therapy, but they actually put in neural stem cells. And they kind of contaminate the field, because then people get very confused. They say pluripotent cells, the ethically correct pluripotent cells. And then if that trial doesn't work, no, it's going to make things difficult. Pluripotent cells failed. And so there's quite a lot of that, in addition to obviously just the regular stem cell tourism, that you can go to many websites and order mesenchymal stem cells, or go to get mesenchymal stem cells for Parkinson's disease. That's a whole other problem. But I think what is interesting, and again, it's again a very interesting political or ethical debate, because now actually I have the two sides, you know, because you have also the company, for example, and there is not the right to try the issue, but the issue is there is the so-called RMAT designation. I don't know whether you've heard of that. It's basically a regenerative medicine advanced therapy designation that you can get from the FDA. And that means that you have now a quicker path to regulatory approval, similar to what was done in Japan a couple of years ago. And so that means you can now finish this phase one, which obviously we're going to do exactly the way. But then afterwards, you can basically make a definitive phase two study. If you get RMAT designation, mean you don't need to do an actual phase three to get regulatory approval. And again, it's obviously good and bad. It could clearly be misused, because then you might have things that has never conclusive efficacy, and it's going to get used. On the other hand, it's going to save $50 or $100 million of development costs, and therefore can get more quickly to the clinic, and we obviously hope things are going to work. But so we'll have to see how that plays out on the long run. It's clearly a lot of potential for abuse, and it's not clear what really you need to show for RMAT designation.
But is it as extreme as in Japan, that you basically don't need to prove efficacy, in any way, just safety, and then you have 7 years of post-market surveillance? I mean, is that as extreme?
I mean, there has been no real... People have gotten RMAT designation for their trial, but nobody has gotten regulatory approval yet via RMAT, so we don't know exactly how it's going to get handled there. But it is an important issue. Okay, any other questions? Okay, if not, we're going to shift gears quite dramatically. So, actually, I should first acknowledge people. Very important. I mentioned Mark actually already, and Stefan, who really did the lion work of really getting the NiceDem project working. And this is Tay, the guy who now develops the BAMCHIR and even newer version than the BAMCHIR protocol. And Chinghua did the preclinical studies in Vivian's lab. And Vivian is, again, not a disclosure, my wife and co-conspirator for the last 20 years, and also the surgeon on this trial. And so she's going to be she's also a neurosurgeon, and she's going to hopefully stick this out into patient. So it's going to be an exciting time on many levels. But anyway, so let's switch gears. A really new story, completely unpublished.